Bradford has always been a hotbed of innovation in science, technology, engineering, and maths. From Titus Salt to Joseph Pepper, one of the architects who designed the Talbot Hotel on Kirgate. From Professor Victoria Braithwaite, who proved that fish feel pain and have the ability to learn directions, which gives them the edge over me. To Baroness Barbara Castle, who introduced the first seatbelts and created permanent speed limits to reduce deaths on Britain's roads. Even Charles Darwin hung out in Ilkley as he relaxed after the release of Origin of the Species, which explains where these images originally came from, I suppose. So I'm here with Elsa and Seth to explore Bradford's innovation heroes. Let's take a trip through time. Whoa! So Elsa, you go to school. What's your favourite school dinner?
Pizza on Fridays.
And what if on a Friday you came in and they said, we haven't got pizza today, what we've got is some stale bread, a banana and some milk that's been topped up with water because we haven't quite got enough?
I think it would be yucky, so I would not really eat it.
But that was a reality for many kids in this city at the start of the 20th century. However, Bradford was about to change things for the better, inventing the school meal. At the start of the 20th century, there was a lot of poverty in Bradford. It was a result of it growing so quickly during the Industrial Revolution. Margaret McMillan swooped in. She was American by birth, Scottish by ancestry, but she took Bradford to her heart, and particularly the children of the city.
Prior to what Margaret McMillan did, it was the responsibility of religious institutions, private charities, individuals to care for the poor. You have things like Cinderella clubs, which were founded to provide food and opportunities for poor people. In fact, the only one to still be going now is in Bradford. And so what Margaret McMillan did was she was part of a movement which believed that actually it was a government's responsibility to do this.
She made sure there were medical inspections in schools. She made sure there were baths in schools. And yes, she started the wheels in motion for free school meals.
And together with a load of others, including Bradford MP Fred Jowett, the name should bring to mind the famous car manufacturers in Bradford, they campaign, and eventually in 1906, the government passes the Provision of School Meals Act, which introduces free school meals.
Some of Fred Jowett's MP friends must have choked on their subsidised lobster linguine at the thought of giving kids free meals. But they did it. It was the Superintendent of Domestic Services in Bradford, Marion Cuff, who went into the schools and practised with a load of different recipes and wrote a big report about the nutrients and vitamins that were needed. It was so advanced for its time at the start of the 20th century. She was like an early Jamie Oliver, but she probably said pucker a lot less. So Bradford became the first city to take advantage of the new rules, and the first school meals were cooked at Green Lane Primary School in Manningham on the pipes that were used to heat the baths. Seriously. Then they deliveroo'd the meals around the rest of the city to the other schools. Oh, and fun fact, the headmaster at the time, this bloke's dad. Yeah, that's right. Playwright J.B. Priestley's dad, Jonathan, was the headmaster at Green Lane Primary. He must have panicked every time an inspector called. An inspector called, you see, it's a... I suit yourself. I'll be honest, what I wanted to do was to feed my kids some of the early school meals because I thought they'd be disgusting, I thought it'd be funny. However, they weren't. They were really decent. Yorkshire cheese pie, sounds lovely. So what I did instead was go to my childhood in the 1980s and serve them a classic from that genre, tapioca.
What is it made of?
What does it look like?
Frog spawn?
It's a bit like a big porridge.
Tastes like dead flies.
Seth, do you want to have a look at these pictures and tell me what you think you see?
Fairies?
Yeah, there's fairies in the pictures. And do you think they're real?
No.
No, they're not real. But a very famous man called Arthur Conan Doyle thought they were real. And he was used to making up a story or two, but he was completely tricked by the Cottingley Fairies. In 1917, Frances Griffiths was 9 years old. She was staying with her 16-year-old cousin Elsie Wright and her family here in Cottingley. They used to really annoy their mums by coming back from playing in the beck all day with really dripping wet clothes. So they did what all kids do. They made something completely ridiculous up.
One day they claimed to have seen fairies in the garden. What they've actually done, however, is just cut out little drawings of fairies from a popular book and stuck them to trees and the ground with pins and then taken photos of them. But soon after, it takes Britain by storm, even fooling people so famous and intellectual as Sir Arthur Conan Doyle.
Rather than admit they'd done something mildly wrong, what they did instead was grab Elsie's dad's camera and go and change the face of photography pretty much forever. When I was 16, basically, I sat on the sofa and ate crisps.
What I think is interesting is because when we look at the photos now, we think, well, they look a bit fake. I mean, how could people have been fooled? But when you look into the story, it's less about people being fooled because the people who were most likely to believe them to be genuine were the people most invested in them. In 1919, the photos were shown at a talk in Bradford about fairies. So obviously the people going to that talk were already interested in the subject anyway. Similarly, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, despite being a highly intelligent man, was already interested in spiritualism. So he took this as proof for the beliefs he already had.
So I thought we should start our own Cottingley Fairies style hoax, but we can't do it with fairies because that's been done. So what can we do it with?
Maybe we could do it with
dinosaurs, of course! Let's do it!
I saw the dinosaur!
So many of Bradford's fortunes are knitted together with the woolen industry, and that pun was entirely intended. It was such a hotbed of textile activity that it became known as the wool capital of the world. Wool City. Woolopolis. Wool I am. I will survive. I made a couple of those up, but you get the idea. In the 19th century, Bradford mill owners were innovating at a great pace. People like Samuel Lister, who invented the nip comb for sorting and straightening raw wool in record time. Not obviously to be confused with the knit comb, which is something entirely different. In fact, if you have head lice, public service announcement, do not use Samuel Lister's nip comb. It will only end in disaster. Perhaps the most famous Bradford mill owner that we still remember today is the one who went above and beyond the call of duty to really improve the conditions of his workers.
The average adult life expectancy for Titus Salt's time in the mid-19th century for an adult was 18 years old, which is remarkable when you think about it. And there's all the levels of infant mortality as well. And what Titus Salt did was he made a purpose-made village or model village for his workers, which could provide them with all the amenities they needed to have a healthy, spiritual and happy life compared to the conditions which the rest of Bradford was in.
In 1836, Titus Salt started experimenting with alpaca wool to make a material he called alpaca. Look, he was an innovator in many ways, just not in terms of language. It worked though, because within 20 years, his business was the biggest employer in Bradford. He needed new premises, but he was concerned about the pollution and the crowded nature of the city centre, so he moved out of town. He found himself a site near Shipley, next to the railway, canal and river, and called it Salt Air.
He gave each house proper sanitation, every single house. Now that might seem like the base expectations for a house for us today, but I mean, that was luxury. Running water, he'd make sure that each house would be in good walking distance to a park or greenery. There was a school, hospital, a church, gymnasiums, no pubs obviously because he was a Methodist. But what he did was that he made sure that every need that an ordinary person would have would be catered for.
And those houses and facilities that he built are still around today, pretty much. They're great family homes, and the sense of community there must have been back in the day when the mill was up and running is the same sense of community there is now. Not everyone works in the same job in the same place, but there's a brilliant sense of community within Salt Air, and that is testament to Titus's hard work and his vision. So Elsa, you do a lot of work for your pocket money. What do you do?
I wash the dishes, help load the dishwasher, mop the floor and tidy my bedroom.
In the 18th and 19th centuries, there were a lot of mills in West Yorkshire that used to employ children. Children of 8 and upwards, which is nearly you, right?
Yeah.
So you wouldn't have been doing the dishes and emptying the dishwasher at that time. Do you know what you might have been doing? You could choose a job, actually, if you want. A piecer used to have to pull out the thread and put it back together, and they used to have to scrunch it back together, and it used to make their hands bleed.
Ew.
Or there was the scavenger who had to go underneath the really dangerous machinery to clean up. You could have done that.
That's scary!
Or you could have just lugged a load of wool around. Now, I've got a challenge. Do you and Seth want to take on a lugging the wool challenge?
Yeah!
I don't have bags of wool, but I do have two boxes of my finest cardigans that you can lug around. That seems good, right? Let's go and do it. Kids, thank you very much for doing that. Now, can you just take them to the dry cleaners?
No, thanks.
Thank you very much for taking this journey through Bradford's innovation heroes with me. There were so many more we could have included. There wasn't time. Maybe there'll be a sequel or sequels. Subscribe to my YouTube channel, youtube.com/bewildereddad, to find out first. Also like, share, comment, all that stuff. Thank you to Bradford Council, Bradford 2025 and Bradford City of Film for making it possible. And thank you to Catherine Waugh from Yorkshire's Hidden History for adding gravitas to the silly jokes that I put in. And thanks to my kids as well for putting up with days out filming. Although I think they secretly enjoy the stardom. Who knows?